everybody. This is Scott Hudspeth with Agent Mastermind. Welcome to the call today. And, man, I'm just I'm going to dedicate this call to Beverly Carter. Again, we just a very, very sad thing that happened a couple weeks ago. And a very dear friend of mine, Eric Sachs, reached out to me and said, hey, man, let's. I think it's a good time to do a safety class. It's always a good time to do a safety class, but never better than right now. So, Eric, man, welcome to the call, man. I really appreciate you reaching out and just saying, hey, man, let me help out. Let me try and calm some people down and get them back to business and thinking just to be safe. And so welcome to the call, brother.
Thank you. It's awesome. It's been a couple of years since I've been on with you guys. So
it's great.
Thanks for having me.
We've been doing this 2.5, almost 3
years.
I
know.
Now. January will be 3 years. Every single week for the last 3 years has been a good time. So
it's a lot of work.
A little bit about Eric. Do you care if I just tell him a little bit about you, man? To start with, and then we'll let you take the reins.
Go for it.
All right, man. So Eric comes with us with a 13-year veteran at Fort Collins Police in Colorado, 5-year detective bureau, and 6 years as field training, and then he was in the patrol car. He had a little niche for a passion in real estate, so he followed his passion, which I'm so glad you did, because we would have never probably met.
Thank you.
He started that, and he built that up to 65 agents before turning it over and selling the company. He's also co-founder of Breakthrough Broker, with 54,000 visits every single month and growing to his Breakthrough Broker website. If you haven't visited Breakthrough Broker, I would highly recommend going there. There's nothing you can buy there. Is that correct?
That is correct.
It's 100% free stuff for agents to grow their business. He is in U.S., Canada, Europe, and Australia. He also has something new that we're going to be talking about down the road. It's called My Online Yard Sign, which is a listing photo branding tool to help agents brand their listings in syndication. And he also speaks on business development throughout the country, and he's jumping on a plane right after this class to head to California. So, Eric, the big topic right now is safety. And, man, I tell you, I had chills the whole time talking with you yesterday, and I just really appreciate, one, your friendship, and two, your willingness to jump on class here and share this with us. So I'm gonna shut up. I got my notepad, and I'm here with you, man.
Awesome. Well, guys, it's always hard to do these things on the computer. It's always much better to do it in person so we can see some body language. But again, I'm super excited. Scott, thanks for having me today. It's a topic I'm passionate about. I want all of us to go home safely every time we work. And so we're going to rock this out. I want you guys to interact, ask questions of Scott on your control panel as we're going, and we will get to him at the end. So what we're going to talk today mainly is, are you ready? We're going to talk about preparation versus panic. We're going to talk about what to do, what to look for as we're going through our jobs. I don't have to go through this, although I will say it was kind of an interesting transition. When I went back to the street from the detective bureau, I was in million-dollar homes in the middle of the night on false burglar alarms. You know, the mouse runs across the floor, sets off the burglar alarm. We'd go in with my rookies. My rookies were looking for bad guys, and I found myself in the kitchen admiring the granite and the backsplash.
So, isn't that funny?
Along with pulling over realtors in Mercedes and BMWs, I thought, man, I could try this out. So I did it. It was fun. It worked out great. A couple other things. I'm SWAT negotiator trained, and so it's fun for me to do real estate and incorporate some of the skills I learned when I was chasing bad guys. What we're going to talk about today in particular, what I want to accomplish is understanding the potential. Now, it's a very sensitive topic right now. We know what's out there. We know what can happen because of what happened to Beverly. But we're going to talk about preparing yourself both mentally and physically, and that's the main way. What I'm going to keep preaching today is be the locked door. I'll explain that to you a little while later, but how to recognize a potential act and how to react and what to do if this happens to you. So if nothing else, I want to raise your awareness today. We're really at a high level of awareness right now, so I also want to bring you down a little bit, make you feel more comfortable in your profession. We're going to talk a little victimology. We're going to provide you with some things and tools to think about. We're going to tie your current skills to new techniques. You guys are real estate professionals. You have some great skills related to what you do. I'm not here to make you paranoid today. We're not going to make you paranoid, but we do want you to feel safer in your career. And we have to put food on the table. We still have to sell homes. This is happening. We still have to show homes. And many of us are still going to do open houses. So I want you to feel safe when you leave the call today. And if we were in person, I'd ask you, what parts of being a real estate agent concern you most in terms of your safety today? What would you guys like to hear about? And that's a really rhetorical question, because we're all concerned because of what happened to Beverly. And we're concerned with going home at night after we show houses, after we do an open house. And I want you to understand the potential out there. This is not new. I'm watching social media and I'm seeing all the things that are being said after what happened to Beverly, but this is not new. So we've been, before what happened to Beverly, we've been going about our profession. We've been showing homes. We've been meeting clients we've never met before. We've been doing open houses. But it's been going on for years. As a matter of fact, not just since 2011 have assaults increased. They've really accelerated. But since 2006, they've been increasing. And typically, I'll do a case study, and I want to get through all of this today in an hour. But this happened in 2010 or 2008. With Ann Walker, Sarah Ann Walker, and it happened in Orange County, where an agent was raped and bludgeoned in 2010. And also in 2010, two agents were murdered on the job. And one of them was found dead inside a home near Kent, Ohio. Now, if you read this, it talks about his death, follows that of another Ohio agent. So this is not just women. A lot of what I've seen on social media in the past 2 weeks has been really geared towards female agents. And I want to calm all agents down. I want you to realize that this is both men and women who can be assaulted. So I hope we have men on the call today, too, that will really look at this potential and decide to do some things to make ourselves safer. So really, why is this happening to realtors? You know, it happens to teachers. It happens in the construction profession. Without all professions in America, you can get hurt. You can be assaulted. But in today's real estate market, in our opinion, the reason it's accelerating from 2006 to 2014-15 is that the market's been difficult. It's been a roller coaster. Even in a good market, we're pushing harder to get the deal done. We're pushing harder to get that paycheck and to work harder and better for our clients. Our value proposition's changing with Zillow, Trulia, and Realtor.com, so we're trying different things. And we may be pushing that safety envelope and pushing safety to the back burner because we're afraid of offending somebody or we're afraid of losing a deal. We really have to reel that in, and we have to be able to articulate to our clients why we need to be safe. And we're going to talk about some of that today. A few more stats. A few years ago, NAR did a really neat survey, 4,300 agents surveyed nationwide, and half of them said they had safety concerns. Now after Beverly, I'll bet you it's closer to 100%. But back then, one in four said they'd been harassed, actually been harassed. I taught a class last week. It wasn't even a safety class. I taught a technology class, and I asked this question, and almost all of them had felt at some point they'd received a phone call or been harassed on the job, didn't felt uncomfortable at an open house. So this should be a priority, and it shouldn't be in the forefront of our minds for the next month because of what happened to Beverly. It should be in the forefront of our minds for the rest of our career and creating a safe environment for all of us. So we're going to talk about what makes a victim. Does anyone have any thoughts on the call? And Scott, pipe up if some people are writing in their control panel. What makes a victim?
What makes a victim? I think it's if you're vulnerable to it. I mean, when you talked a couple, I don't want to blow like what you're going to talk about, but I mean, I think just being alone would make you a victim.
Okay. So you can be alone. I think you can still be alone and not have the word victim stamped on your forehead. But we, in real estate, you've seen the agents who are running around with papers, flying all over the place and going to show properties, and they don't even know the combo to the property. We're going to talk a little bit about
unprepared, right?
Common victimology, crime of opportunity. So the FBI did a really neat study a couple of years ago. And what they did was they took three of the nation's top burglars, and they took them out of jail, and they sat in a car with FBI agents. And the FBI agents were doing a study. And they said, what did you look for in creating your burglaries? What did you do when you were looking for homes to burglarize? And you know what each one of these top burglars did? They went door to door checking doorknobs. And what happened was they burglarized, guess what?
The ones that were open.
The doors that were open. And so what happens is bad guys, they're cowards, guys and girls on this call. Bad guys are cowards, most of them. They're looking for crimes of opportunity. Burglars don't want to go into homes that are locked. They don't want to go into a home where the lights are on, and they don't want to go into a home where there's a dog. So they keep checking and checking and checking and checking until they find a home that's open, that's easy to burglarize. People who want to break into cars, they walk down neighborhood streets at night and they check doors. They don't want to break a window. They don't want to be caught. The door that's open, they burglarize. They steal stuff out of the car. The burglars steal stuff out of the easy homes. So what I want to talk about today is you guys being the locked door. I want you guys to not be that crime of opportunity. And we're going to talk about, you know, I see online, let's get apps. Let's get all these apps on our phone. How about not even needing the app? How about never being in a situation that you would need a safety app on your phone? And that would be if you're the locked door. Don't be the crime of opportunity. Do not. And we're going to talk a little bit about how we get there. But if we take nothing else away today, I want you guys to be that locked door, that house with the locked door, with the light on, that the burglar is not going to go in. One quick tip on social media. This is a new slide in the presentation, and I'll touch on it for 2 seconds. But social media is so big in our industry, and there's so many coaches and trainers out there teaching you guys how to manipulate social media and use social media for your benefits. I'm one of them. But when it comes to safety, use common sense. How many times have you guys seen on your Facebook feeds, sitting out on County Road 32, no one's been by this open house, I'm so bored. Make sure you come by.
Yeah.
I'm all by myself. Or they tweet out, open house up on Drury Lane, and no one's come by. I'd love someone to come by. So you guys have to be very careful in your social media to announce your statuses, to announce where you are or who you're with, to make sure you're not stamping the word victim on your forehead. Remember, we want to be a closed door. We want to be that locked door. So be careful with your social media. I could go on about safety and social media. I don't want to go there today. We have too much to talk about. We're going to talk about preparation. There's no secrets. It's a lot of common sense stuff we're going to talk about today, but many of the concepts can be applied to everyday life. So we're going to go over, we're going to try to give a real estate twist to all of this, and I want you to share some of this with your coworkers and the people you care about within your company. Many of these concepts we're going to talk about draw on the skills you already have as successful real estate agents, but we're just going to redefine some of these skills to keep you safe in real estate. What's super cool about real estate agents is we possess a skill set, a toolbox, that makes us great realtors. That same toolbox can make you very safe, believe it or not. And what those skills are in this toolbox is some of us can be aggressive, right? We're salespeople. Right. I hope you all realize we're in sales, right? And so at some point we have to be aggressive. We're aggressive in our negotiations tactics. We're aggressive in marketing and trying to get new clients every day. We can be decisive, too. In meeting with your clients, in talking about real estate, in your profession, you can be decisive decision makers. I hope you are. It's what makes a great real estate agent. Verbal judo. We can handle objections. You know, I really want to buy that $300,000 home for $200,000. Well, you know, John, I don't really think we can do that in today's market. Everyone would love a half-price home. If I can find a half-price home, I'd probably buy it before you do. We want you, right? So you guys are all good at that. You're all good at handling objections. You're good at handling your clients, being decisive and aggressive in the sales world. These are all things that we're good at. Observation skills. We can observe when the client's ready to buy. We always observe who the boss is. You leave a meeting and you're like, man, that the wife is who I need to sell. She's going to be the one who makes the decision here. You guys have great observation skills. And you're people. Most realtors are good people, if that's good English.
Right.
You have good people skills, right? And so all of these skills can be utilized in keeping yourself safe. So being mentally prepared is one thing that we're going to first talk about. So it's the best way to foresee, evade, or survive an encounter. And when I talk encounter, it can be theft, it can be assault, it can be sexual assault. Can be any of what we're talking about today. But the goal of being mentally prepared is to never place yourself in a bad situation. It's the best way. Never be there. Be the locked door.
You know, and after you said that first line there, I think about when I'm going to do something, how many people are on their phones, how many people are having a phone conversation, and they're not in the moment.
Yep. And yep, we're going to talk about
not,
that.
And you might be talking about that. I just wanted to think about, you know, because, I mean, we're so busy. We're running around, got kids. You know, you have to be here a certain time. You have to, you know, so all this stuff going on. We're not mentally prepared, and I think that's a huge, huge lesson for me is, you know, when you do go to show a home, make sure that you're mentally there and go through all these steps before you actually take, you know, are there, you know, the awareness, yeah.
Absolutely, and we're going to talk about stages of awareness and where we should be in our mental state when we're meeting and connecting with clients or potential clients. So, you know, the first part of being mentally prepared is awareness of your surroundings. It's mental rehearsal, and we're going to talk about all this. It's develop basic plans, your religious beliefs, and be ready to be aggressive. So first and foremost, the awareness of your surroundings is really important. Where are you meeting your client? Are you meeting your client in a public place? Are you meeting your client at the office? A lot of places are instituting some great new standards for meeting someone you've never met before. Are you bringing someone with you? The next thing I want to talk about is what I feel is most important to being prepared. Mental rehearsal. Now, you guys, anybody watch golf on the call today? Professional golfers take thousands and thousands and thousands of swings every year. And when they step up to the ball, their muscles remember those swings. It's called muscle memory. When you're a police officer, we rehearse in our heads and we practice deadly encounters all the way to simple fights with bad guys, and we rehearse it over and over and over again. And when I was talking to Scott yesterday, he was really amazed to hear that when police officers, and I hope we have some on the call today, maybe we do, when police officers are interviewed after a deadly encounter, after they're in a shooting situation with a suspect, 9 times out of 10, the police officers don't remember even firing their weapon, and they certainly can never say how many rounds they fired during a deadly encounter. The reason is because you go into fight or flight mode, and your muscle memory takes over. You don't remember what happens. The next thing you know, it's over. But you've gone over it in your head over and over and over. Now, if you've never been, if you're a realtor, and you've never been in a fight in your life, you've never been punched in your face really hard, how are you going to react if it does happen to you? What happens is if you've never rehearsed in your mind what you're going to do, then your body does not react when it happens to you. So I want to talk about mental rehearsal. When I would drive around in my police car, I would rehearse every single possible thing that could happen to me. And now that I'm a realtor, I have rehearsed every single thing that could happen to me. If I'm showing property, and the person I'm showing property to wants to see the basement and wants me to walk down first, what am I going to say? I'm going to say, you know, John, I don't show basements. You're welcome to go down there. I'll be up here. As a matter of fact, I'll be waiting for you outside. I knew exactly what I'd say if that happened to me. Okay? And so my mental rehearsal, I know exactly what's going to happen to me if someone hits me on the back of the head. Listen, guys, if we're going to talk about what we call code red, if you're involved in a physical threat, we're going to talk about that later. But if you mentally rehearse it over and over and over again in your mind, your brain will remember this rehearsal and you'll go into action. And it's especially important in our profession when most of us have never been in this situation in our entire life. Most of us have never been here. So mental rehearsal, very important. Develop basic plans. So in your mental rehearsal, if I meet somebody and they're invading my space and I feel uncomfortable at a house, what am I going to do? I'm going to unlock the back door. I'm going to know my exit strategies. And my basic plan is to sit outside and wait for them to be done or call a friend to come meet me. We're going to talk about some other things, but develop some basic plans in your mental rehearsal for the things that could happen. Remember what you're fighting for. In your mental rehearsals, you're fighting for your life. You're fighting to be able to go home to your family, your friends, and the right to live. So you should get really angry. We're going to talk about that again later in a few minutes too. Religious beliefs. At some point in a deadly encounter, you're going to have to be aggressive. So if you never say a bad word in your life, and by the way, I usually have a typical, when you teach the cops, if you don't say the F word in the first 5 minutes, you lose all credibility. So again, I apologize up front, but if you guys never say a bad word in your life, now may be the time to say a bad word. We're going to talk a little bit later about command presence, what it's like to be really listened to with a guy who or gal who wants to hurt you. And be ready to be aggressive. Preparing yourself physically. Stay in decent health, guys. Do you carry keys, mace, taser, a gun? Have you practiced verbal challenges and body language? So I think it's important, and this is common sense, to stay in decent health. I'm not going to dwell on that. But if you guys carry mace, taser, a handgun, keys, and you think you're going to defend yourself with that, great. But the time to figure out how the mace can works is not when you're being assaulted. The time to figure out your proficiency with your handgun is not when you're being assaulted. If you've never used your taser anywhere, ever, the first time is not when you're being assaulted. So make sure you've practiced this. Have you been to a handgun class with your gun? Have you actually sprayed pepper spray? Have you sprayed yourself with pepper spray? That sounds funny, but you should know what it feels like, because if you spray someone else, the chances are you're going to get a little in your face, and you should not let that incapacitate you. We're going to talk about some of this later. Do you carry keys, and what are you going to do with the keys if you get presented in a situation? We're going to talk about that in a minute, too. But if you carry and have in your plan, in your mental rehearsal, if you carry some sort of self-defense mechanism, make sure it's practiced. Verbal challenges. What are you going to say? Do you think if somebody's there to hurt you, do you think, you know, John, I really don't feel comfortable? Or do you think, get the fuck away from me? Right. Which is better?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Which is better? I apologize for my language, guys, but we talked before. Yep. Verbal challenges, you have to be the locked door. Bad guys are cowards. They are not going to hurt someone who they feel is going to be a problem. They're going to move on to the next one who's not going to be a problem. Right. So have you practiced, have you thought of what you're going to say to someone who's making you feel uncomfortable? What are your verbal challenges? All this goes back to your mental preparation. It goes back to your role play in your head as to anything that can happen when you're a realtor. You should role play it. And again, over and over, what are you going to say? Have you practiced? The comfort bubble. We're going to talk about the shark nudge.
I love this is a big deal. Yeah, I love this part.
So if you, my kids love Shark Week, right? When Shark Week comes on, we watch Shark Week incessantly. There's all kinds of stupid stuff like Sharknado and blah, blah, blah. But I like the scientific part of Shark Week. And sharks, a lot of shark bite victims say that the sharks nudged them with their nose once or twice before they were bit. They got nudged in the leg. They got nudged in the body. The shark wants to know what their prey is, how they're going to react before they bite them. Bad guys do very much the same thing. They may call you and say, hey, I'd really love to see this house. I want to buy your home in cash, and I'd like to see you in an hour. They're testing to see how you react. They may come into an open house and try to invade your personal space. That's a shark nudge. They want to see how you react. Do you move away? Do you place the table between you and them? How are you reacting to their shark nudge? Do not let anyone invade your comfort bubble. And we're going to talk about how soon. Know what your comfort bubble is. Some people, I'm a hugger, right? And so I hug people all the time. I have a really close comfort bubble.
Yep.
It's just what is your comfort bubble? And are you recognizing the sharp nudges? Are you recognizing what people are doing and saying?
Are you in the moment?
Are you in the moment? And then body language. Body language, body language, body language, both yours and theirs. So if you're paying attention to your phone, if you're watching your every 2 seconds, looking at your text message, looking at your Facebook while you're with this person, you're providing an opportunity. If you're slouched, if you don't know where you're going, if you're lost, if you don't know the combo to the home that you're showing, if you're holding 52 MLS listings in both of your hands, you're a crime of opportunity waiting to happen. If you're confident, if you stand erect, if you walk with conviction, you are not. Your body language is showing them that you're in control and you're not going to be a victim. You need to watch their body language. What are they looking at? You're there to show a home. Are they looking at you and your car, at your really nice watch, or are they looking at the house? These are all things you have to pay attention to when you're working on that.
That has to be like that. Truthfully, has to be the biggest one, right? I mean, they're not looking at the house or asking any questions about the house. It's probably not a good sign.
Absolutely. Some of those are sharp nudges too, and you have to be aware of them. We're going to talk about that in our response to what they're doing. But have one or two prepared immediate physical responses. You don't need 100. You need one or two. And be ready to move quickly and decisively, hit hard and fast, like your life depends on it, and you must be aggressive. Oops, let's go back. So let's talk about be ready to move quickly and decisively. This is pretty interesting. When you, again, if you've never been in a fight before and someone's actually physically assaulting you, you have to know what you're going to do, and this comes in your mental preparation. I keep going back to your role play. What are you going to do? We'll talk in a minute. I like grab, twist, and pull. We'll talk about that in a minute. But be ready to move decisively. If you've never been in a fight before, something really interesting happens. When you hurt somebody, you tend to stand there and watch.
Yep.
Now, after you hurt somebody, after you grab, twist, and pull, or poke an eye out, or do whatever it is you need to do to survive, you don't stand and watch. We're going to talk about you leave that area quickly. You hit hard and fast like your life depends on it. Get angry, be aggressive, and then you run and get someone's attention. You don't stand there and watch admiring the hurt you put on someone or how much the mace is actually stinging their eyes. You run. You get out of there. So we're going to talk about awareness colors. We're going to talk about white, and that's what Scotty was just talking about, when you're completely unaware of your surroundings. That's white. We see, and I managed realtors who were in this all the time. We really want to be in yellow all the time. This is a relaxed awareness. Orange is a specific threat has been identified, and red is you are under attack. Red is time to tick. So we're going to talk about all of these, and black is actually panic. We never want to get to panic. Now, you won't panic if you role play all of this in your head. So condition white, if you walk around in life and think this will never happen to me, I feel really bad for what happened to Beverly, I feel bad to what happened to those realtors in Ohio in 2010, but I live and work in the safest place in the world, this will never happen to me. I can talk my way out of anything. I've talked to a lot of men in this industry who say this to me. When I teach this class, I have guys say, I can talk my way out of anything. All right. Have you figured out how you're going to talk your way out of a .45 caliber gun being held to your head when they want your car? You know, have you role played that? Great. Tell me you can talk your way out of anything, but make sure you role play it. Are you distracted during initial contact? No qualifying questions before or during. Again, looking at your texts, thinking about what you're going to do that night. Distracted or out of the office when showing or in person. Again, out of the office means, just like Scott said, not present in the moment. No plan before, during, or after. If you have not mentally rehearsed what you're going to do, if you haven't figured out that you're going to walk into a home when you're showing a property, you're going to let your client in first, you're going to walk in behind them, and the first thing you're going to do is tell them to check out the kitchen, and you're going to walk to the back door and unlock the back door. Why? Because mentally you've rehearsed that you always want two exits everywhere you go. When you go into your open house and you're sitting in the open house, where are you going to sit? Are you going to sit in the middle of the living room with a little table that you brought? Or are you going to be closed in the kitchen where there's only one way in and one way out? You're going to think about these things. You're going to sit in the middle of the living room and you're going to unlock the back door. You're going to unlock the door to the garage and you're going to have the front door unlocked. So if anything happens and you need to leave, you've got three exit routes and you've thought about these things. In white, you don't think about any of this and you're totally oblivious to the threats of the world around you. Now, we don't, being in white is...
I think the big part is, like, we as people in general are trustworthy. I mean, we trust people.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And that's the sad part, that we can't trust people. We have to actually just be aware of our surroundings.
Right. I'm not talking about being paranoid forever.
I
like, you know, you can go on vacation and be in white. I probably live in yellow my whole life, and it's because of what I did in the past. But it's okay to be at white sometimes, but it's not okay to be in white when you're working, when you're meeting a client. And so I agree. And so again, physically, anyone in the white condition, awareness level, during this, has victim stamped on their forehead. You have no escape plan. You've not prepared verbal challenges or objections. You've done no role play in your head. You're wearing expensive jewelry, clothing. This is a conversation I get in when I teach the class in person. How do you guys feel about clothing? What do you wear? Is it conservative? Is it racy? I don't know answers to this. You have to figure out what you want to wear. Do you have your cell phone out? Do you have your keys in your pocket? You have to think about where you're at and what you're going to do. And if you're in condition white, none of this has come to your mind. This is where I would like most of you to be when you're working, whether you're at the office, whether you're meeting a client. Condition yellow is relaxed awareness. It's being present in the moment, like Scott said. It means having role-played what could happen to you so that you know what you're going to do if it does happen to you. And it starts with the first contact. So someone in condition yellow may make notes when they call you. What did they sound like? What were they talking about? Were they talking about the home? Were they knowledgeable about houses? Or were they talking about me? So in your haste to make the sale or get a client, don't slip back into white. Remember, in yellow, we're asking additional questions. We have a higher level of awareness. Do they sound right? Are they answering qualifying questions right? You know, Eric, I really want to go see this foreclosure you have for sale on Woodrow Drive. I want to pay cash and I want to see it in an hour. Great. And what's your name again? It's John. And your last name, Smith. Awesome, John. I'm just taking some stuff down for my notes. What's your birth date again? What do you mean? What do you need my birthday for? I just need it for all my stuff. And by the way, let's meet at Starbucks. That's a couple blocks away. And have your proof of funds available from the bank that you're going to buy this in cash for, because I just have to have that for my records. Click. That was a sharp nudge. They were seeing if I would go show the property without asking those questions. Now, I mentally rehearsed those questions, so I knew that's what I was going to ask if this ever popped up. Do they sound right? If they say, yeah, absolutely. Bank of America is where my cash is. I'll bring a letter from them. I'm happy to meet you at Starbucks. I've been looking at foreclosures all over the city. This one seems to be, you know, in my price range. That would sound right to me. First contact. Do an assessment when you meet them in a public place, at the Starbucks, at the local coffee shop, at your office. What kind of car are they driving? If they're going to buy a $400,000 or $500,000 home and they roll up in a Pinto, that's probably a clue in my past life, right? You know, where are you looking? Is their appearance go along the lines of an investor that's buying a bunch of properties, or are they buying a big 4,000 square foot home for themselves, or are they a family? I mean, these are things that you want to look at when you first meet with them in a public place. More mental condition yellow. When you're inside the house, when you're showing a home, how do you show it? Where do you walk? Where do you stand? Now, in talking to Scott yesterday, I would like you guys in condition yellow to always be physically in control of your client. When you go up to the door and you're getting the code or the key, ask them to stand away from you for a second. Hey, can you just wait right here? I'm going to get the code. You want a few feet between you and your client. You don't want them right on top of you, whether you know them or not. You get the key out. You open the door. Who goes in first? You let your client walk in first. You're always behind them. And you manipulate your client's physical activities with yours because you're confident. You're in yellow. Eric, go check out the kitchen. While I'm checking out the kitchen, you're unlocking the back door so that you have an escape route if you need it. Okay? So where do you walk and where you stand is really important. Have a plan. Again, if this person attacks me, what am I going to do? What am I what am I going to do? And you should have this mental rehearsal. I'm going to hit hard. I'm going to hit fast. I'm going to be aggressive, and I have my escape routes. Call a friend. Do they have a plan? Don't get distracted. Know the combo at the door. Don't have to call. Don't have to search. Make sure your hands are free. So again, this is a big thing for cops. They always make sure their hands are free. Don't be holding a million things. Take a briefcase, have it over your shoulder, but make sure your hands are always free. Hands that are busy can't help you. If they're holding on to a million different things, they can't help you. And then prey versus predator. You know, you never want to be the prey. You don't have victim stamped on your forehead. You always have to be in control and in charge of yourself, physically and mentally. So know your escape routes. Here's a little thing I'd like for you guys to do if you'd like. If I have some managing brokers on the call and you guys are concerned with implementing policy at the office for safety, here's a little thing I like. There's all these apps out there, they're great, but what if your front desk knows that you're showing a house at 10 o'clock and at 10 minutes in you call the front desk to make sure, to let them know you're okay. In police terms, we'd always say we're code 4, we're okay on a contact. So maybe you guys call the front desk and say everything's going great, thanks, or you have a code word. And the front desk knows that if you haven't called 10 minutes into your showing, they need to try to get a hold of you. So again, phone a friend or an office at 10 minutes with a safety word or phrase. So again, if we're talking about implementing new policy at your office, this is a really great one. This is a way to notify a person that you're okay or not okay.
Or this could and be with this could be with the buddy system too, right?
Yeah, and if something's going bad, if you don't feel comfortable, there's a code word. So we can talk about this after too, if you'd like. Control the conversation. So what if you're showing a property, and again, the talk is off topic. They're talking about you and not the home. They're looking at you and not the home. They're talking about your really cool car and your nice watch and not the home. These are bad signs. And again, I hope you role play this. You know, John, I know my car is cool, and I bought this watch. It's a really cool watch. I'm going to be outside. You keep taking a look at the house. When you're done, come check with me outside. So, you got a role play in your head. What are you going to say? What are you going to do if someone decides to do this? Listen to your tummy. Listen to your inner voice, your gut.
It's funny you bring that up. Shiloh is on the call, and she says, okay, what if my stomach just doesn't feel right about this? You leave. You absolutely get out of the house.
Yeah. Listen to it and
listen to it.
Role play in your head. If I'm showing a home and my stomach doesn't feel good about what's going on, what am I going to do? I'm going to call the office with my code word that things aren't going well. I'm going to go sit in the car. And maybe the office sends someone out to you, or maybe you leave. It's okay. Safety first. And so, good question. Don't place the sale over safety. So condition yellow physical responses. Be prepared to act but not paranoid. And again, that gut response, we want you to listen to it. But again, we don't want you to be paranoid. So if you guys prepare mentally, you won't be paranoid. Keep your comfort bubble intact. If you're doing an open house and you're the only one there, and someone comes in and starts to shark nudge you by invading your space, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Maybe place a table or a chair and use your body language and where you're standing to place a barrier between you. Always keep your comfort bubble intact. Practice that. You can practice that. You know, you can circle a chair when someone's trying to get close to you with your spouse. Have your spouse practice this with you. Place obstacles between you and that person to keep your comfort bubble intact. It'll keep you the locked door. They'll move on to the next open house. What do you guys think command presence means? Command presence is what you portray, the aura that you give out when you're with a person. Now, there's very few cops that you'll meet that will come to a call and be slouched over, that'll be dressed sloppily, and that'll look at the ground when they're talking to you. Most cops stand up straight. They talk to you eye to eye. They're in a bladed stance, which is actually ready to fight. And so your command presence is really important. How do you portray yourself when you meet someone? You stand up tall, you shake their hand, you look in their eyes, you speak legibly, you tell them, do me a favor, please wait right here while I go ahead and get the key. No, I want to be right with you. No, I want you to wait here, I'll get the key, and then we'll go in. How you hold yourself and handle yourself is, in my opinion, one of the best ways to be a locked door. Because again, they're just like the burglar. You're not an open door if they see you as difficult to assault. And command presence is a big deal. Keep defensive tools ready and hands-free. So if you carry mace or a taser, where are they? Are they buried in the bottom of your purse? Or are they in the car if you don't have a purse? Where are they? Are they ready? If you have a briefcase, are they at the top? Can you get to it quickly? If you choose to have a defensive tool, it, number one, you should know how to use it. We already talked about that. And number two, it should be in a place where you can get to it. And control body movement. Again, this comes with command presence, but you have them walk first. You tell them, let's go look at the kitchen, and they walk in first. If it's a standoff, you just wait there with your hand up. Go ahead in. You go look at the kitchen first. So control their body movement with your body movement.
Wouldn't you say command presence is another like really, really important one, like confidence and just be ready at all points? I mean, it's like, again, being in the moment. I keep stressing that. But, I mean, I think command presence is huge. After you explain that.
Right.
That makes total sense.
Think about some of our partners in real estate that we know. I mean, I've seen, you know, I watch my agents walk out of the door of the office with 22 MLS sheets in their hand. You know, and their books and their briefcase and their phone, and, you know, they're not ready for, they're calling their assistant for the combo that they forgot, and they're kind of slouched over. You have to show that command presence, and that'll be one thing that just locks the door for the bad guy. So let's talk about a threat. How do you know when you're in trouble, and what are the signs? So some indicators of being in trouble. Now, we want you not to get to this point. My hope is that through yellow awareness, you guys don't get here, that things are going great and that you're the closed door and there's nothing stopping you to sell a home safety-wise. But let's look at some indicators if you do get there, because, you know, all the preparation in the world can still get you in a situation that you don't want to be in. So if the conversation is off the house and on you, and we talked about that, but that is a huge clue. Bells should be going off in your head. No conversation at all or one-word reply. So the opposite, they don't want to talk. One-word replies, yes, no, maybe, yes. That's, again, an indicator that should be having your bells and whistles go off. Invading your comfort bubble, invading your, you know, a little sharp nudges, touching your back, touching your arm, walking too close, wanting you to walk first, all testing you. All really pushing you to see how you're going to react. And again, that is like the burglar checking the front doors. You know, if they touch your back and you don't have a response, that sharp nudge worked. Mm-hmm. That bad guy's mind is working. All right, I just touched her back. Now I want to try to get her in a quiet corner of this house. And now they're in control. But if someone touches your back and you've mentally rehearsed what's going to happen if a client you've never met touches your back, and you turn around with command presence and you say, John, don't touch me. If we need someone else to show you this house, that's fine. Because that's what you rehearsed. That sharp nudge did not work. And the sharp nudge of trying to get you to go first in the door did not work. That bad guy's done. He is not going to want to hurt you. The two sharp nudges, the three sharp nudges he tried, didn't work. He's not going to bite you. Where is their attention? And again, we really want to focus on bad guy's attention. You'll know, you've shown a lot of houses and you've done a lot of open houses as realtors. You'll know what's not right. This is what's going to make that feeling in your stomach that you just talked about go off. Where is their attention? Is he moving you around the house? Again, we want to talk about that body language.
Very important. Very important.
Is he moving you? Is he close? Is he trying to get you into a back room? Is he trying to get you going to the basement? So really, those are all really indicators. Are they nervous? Are they looking for witnesses? Are they darting their eyes when they, you know, when you get out of the car? Are they looking at neighbors' doors? Are they looking up and down the street in a way that you've never seen before? Is it different from the person who's really interested in a house and they're looking at the neighbors saying, man, the lawn's really good. It's really nice to see the neighbors keep up their lawns. There's no cars on blocks here. I love it. Or are they looking around to see if anyone's out there? Okay. Is it an odd hour? Did they ask you to go to a home at a time where people won't be in the neighborhood? So make sure if they're nervous, if their eyes are looking around, if your creep alarm is going off, that's feeling in your stomach. And utilize your skills as a realtor to realize this. Condition orange. Now we got a problem, right? We've gone from yellow to orange. My creep alarm went off. Things are not right. So we've escalated from yellow to orange. Don't second guess yourself. Guys, don't second guess yourself. Get out of the situation. Don't say, well, let me spend 10 more minutes with this guy, see where it goes. I really need the $10,000 commission. Let's see where this goes. That'll get you in trouble. If your creep alarm goes off and you've now escalated to orange, it's probably time to get out. Know your plan and use it. So you're in the house. You've asked him to go check out the kitchen. He didn't want to. He wanted to keep talking about you. You've unlocked the back door. He's following you around. He's moving you around. He's asked to see the basement or the upstairs bedroom, and your creep alarm is going off. Don't second guess yourself. What's your plan? What have you thought about doing? All right. Well, my creep alarm's going off. I'm in a house. I'm not having fun. I'm going to call my office. I'm going to check in and give him a code word that says things aren't going well. And I'm going to go back to the car. I'm going to tell my client whatever your plan in your mind says. I'm having a problem at home. I got to take off. Have a great day. I'm out of here. Or lock the door or don't lock the door. Don't worry about those things. Get someone else to go lock the door after you leave. It doesn't matter. Get out. Have strong verbal response ready. Remember we talked, I said the F word really loud. Some of you guys might have been offended. I hope not. But have your verbal response ready. This is the time to go for it. John, get your hands off me. Immediate excuse to leave. Those are all done in your role play. Don't wait until it's time. Guys, I keep talking about that. Role play, role play, role play in your head. Store things about the person for later report to police. So remember, guys.
Tara Lee said, this was great. Tara Lee said she takes a picture of the car when it pulls
it
up. And they let them see her take the picture.
Perfect. I love it. So this is this point right here. Store things about the person for later report to police.
Yep.
The car. Take a picture of the car. I love it. You know,
let
make
them
sure
see you do it. You know, let them see you do it. And then text a picture of the car to your friend or whatever. I mean, it's really easy to do.
Yep. And if someone says, what are you doing? You say, well, we're safe at our office.
Yeah.
And I loved your car, so I took it. And don't panic. Now, you guys are going to get sick of hearing me say this. But the easiest way not to panic is if you role-played this in your head over and over and over. You're driving the kids to school. Role-play this in your head. You're driving to work. Role-play it. You got an hour and a half drive somewhere else. Role-play it. Because by role-playing, by understanding how you're going to react in a really scary situation, you will not panic. You won't panic. It's how we did as cops when we were in a scary situation. We didn't panic because we practiced it a million times, literally, before it ever happened to us. And sometimes it never happened to any of us in a 20-year career, but sometimes scary things did happen, and we handled it and didn't panic because we practiced it in our heads. Physically, we're in condition orange. What do we do physically? We're no longer in yellow. Our creep meter's going off. What do? We take control. We implement our plan. We control the conversation and look for responses. You start asking a lot of questions. You get them talking. You get them to focus on the house, and you ask a lot of questions. You move towards your exit or your escape route physically. As you're asking them questions, what do you think of the kitchen? Granite's nice. What are the kids going to think of the backyard? They're thinking of responses. You're moving your body to the exit. Back door, front door, side door, doesn't matter. You role play this in your head, and you know what you're going to do. Do not hesitate. Don't think again, let me give this guy another 10 minutes. Let's see where this goes. Let's see where this goes. Could be really bad for you. Prepare for possible immediate physical response. Remember, if you guys are in yellow, 99.9% of the time you will never be here. And just like being a police officer, 99.9% of cops in America never have to fire their firearm in a 30-year career. But we're ready for it if we have to. 99.9% of you on this call, 99.9% of the 1,000,005 realtors in America will never have to be here. But prepare yourself in case you are here. Because that 1%, that 0.1%, we don't want to be you. If you maintain your business in yellow, you won't be here. But if you are here, prepare for possible immediate physical response. Now. Now is the time. Condition red. Maybe you've done everything right, and you've gotten yourself in a situation where there is a true threat. Do you fight or do you give in? Now, this is all part of your role play. What do you do? Do you get aggressive in your thinking? Remember who you have to go home to. Get angry and use your anger to give yourself some resolve. Polite, uncomfortable, socially unacceptable behavior is no longer a concern. Mm-mm. Don't worry about grabbing that man's private part. Don't worry about poking his eyeball out. Don't worry about pulling hair. Don't worry about saying bad words. If you're in condition red, you will survive because you've role-played it in your head over and over and over. You will survive. And here's the thing, too, guys. This is a side note. It's not in here. If you get punched, hit, stabbed, or shot, and you know you got punched, hit, stabbed, or shot, you're probably going to live. Okay? So don't panic. As police officers, we know that if we get shot and we know we got shot, we're probably going to live. Okay? So if you get punched, stabbed, hit, or shot, or pushed, or whatever, and you know it happened, keep going through your plan. And now is not the time to be polite. Say the F word, punch, gouge, kick, scream, put your survival plan into action, and your planned response into action. So we want to talk about hitting hard and hit often, then run. Remember, do not stand around. You empty your pepper spray can, and the guy's rolling around in pain, and you get a small smile in your face, and you watch for a few minutes. Not a good time to. Grab, twist, and pull, poke your eyes, whatever. Don't be afraid to get personal. Remember what they're trying to take from you, and channel that anger in that response. So after this, make sure you call police first. Something really funny happens in this world of social media and friends and instantaneous. We saw it at the police department right when I was getting out in 2008. Victims would often call a friend before they'd call the police department. Don't. Call 911 as soon as this happens. What should you do? You make notes of what happens as soon as you get away. You have a description of the vehicle. If you're still alive, you'll be okay. And again, if you're still alive, you'll be okay. One of the things in condition red that I want to talk about is remember that now is not the time to wonder how your weapon works. If you're in condition red, now is not the time to figure out how to unlock the safety on your pepper spray or how to or that your taser's not charged and ready to go. Now is not the time. Also, you know, one of the things as you're role-playing, you know, one of the things that happened when we teach this class in person, we do a little, I don't know if you guys, if anyone's on the call in Colorado, we've had a lot of school shootings in Colorado. And as police officers, we've done a lot of debriefing. Well, several years ago, there was a shooting in Bailey, Colorado, where a gunman took a whole class hostage for about 5 hours. And that gunman lined all the women up along the wall, all the girls in the class up along the wall, and sexually assaulted several of them. But during that sexual assault, several other girls had prepared responses. Girls were saying things like, you know, I'm on my period, or I have herpes. They had role-played this in their head. And the girls who said these things were not assaulted during that really scary time. And so do you guys have statements prepared in your role play? If someone's trying to hurt you, what are these verbal statements? What are these commands to try to get them to stop? And so the role play for these girls during the Bailey shooting, Bailey High School shooting, it really kept them alive. It kept them not being assaulted. And, you know, does your attacker want something other than you? Is this a robbery motive? For many of the men on the call, most men assaulted and murdered in our profession are robbery motives. They want your nice watch. They want your nice BMW. They want something you have, and you're an easy target. So what are you going to do in your role play? Are you going to hand it to them or throw it behind them so you can run? If they want your car, maybe you throw the car keys and run. So if it's a theft response, or if they're trying to sexually assault you, maybe you have some of these statements so that they think twice and that it gives you a second to respond to your physical reaction. Any questions about that sort of stuff?
No, so that's great stuff, man.
If we recap a little bit, I want everyone on the call to be a locked door. If you live your life, your professional life, in yellow, relaxed awareness, and you're in the moment, and you plan mental rehearsal, you're going to avoid these situations, and you're going to be able to go sell a lot of homes for the next 20 years as a realtor and never have a problem. So I really want you guys to be in the moment. I want you to really go ahead and role play anything bad. It's great to be prepared for the worst and hope for the best.
Absolutely.
So, and then last, use the skills you already have in this mental preparation. You guys are good talkers. You're very observant. And hopefully, over time, again, I want you guys to feel safe in your profession. And if you do the things in yellow, you'll be safe and you'll be able to sell a lot of homes and be safe forever. What questions do we have, Scott?
Awesome, awesome class, man. So Michelle, I just wrote down a bunch of notes, and there's a ton of great stuff. Michelle says when she calls to check in, she says green folder or red folder. Green folder means everything's okay. Like, hey, it's in the green folder. Hey, it's in the red folder. Or, hey, could you check in the green folder? Like, so green is good, red is bad.
Perfect.
That's her check-in point. I thought that was great. So
absolutely
that could be your
code word.
Yep,
great job,
great.
Guys. Love it.
I love the picture of the car, picture of the person. Even if you're not doing it, if you're taking that, I mean, just in I would do it. I love that. Alicia said, what about the homeowner's possessions? I guess you have to determine whether that's more important or your life. How would you respond to that, Eric?
So good question. I mean, if you just turn and run and leave that person in the house, I would say if your bells and whistles are going off and it's time to turn and run, the homeowner's possessions are not your problem.
Absolutely. Yeah, safety's more first. Lindsay, she said she used to be good, but now she's pregnant. So she has those concerns as far as health and pregnancy and different disabilities as far as that goes. Any suggestions on that front?
You know, I would say just
a partner maybe.
Yeah, a partner or show property until you don't feel, you know, I think if you maintain these same skills, you won't get yourself in that situation. At the time you feel unable to show properties, have someone else do it for you or go with you. Good question, though.
Yeah, great question. Another one, this is a good one. JH said, ride in the car. A couple of people asked this. Ride in the car or have them drive their own car?
Well, I'm also a big fan of being a great buyer's agent. And in my opinion, being a great buyer's professional, you ride in a car with people because it's the best way to remember, guys, we're in this profession to make money, right? And we want to get referrals for the rest of our life. So before you make that decision, you meet them in a public place. So you're going to meet your client at home, or not at home, at a coffee shop or at the office.
Sure.
After the decision is made that you feel comfortable these are real buyers, I say drive with them because you've made the decision already. So you got to balance
you do some qualifying questions and all that. You do all the stuff in yellow that you would normally do with the qualifying a person.
Absolutely. So good question.
Have they talked to a lender? Are they approved? You know, I mean, all the normal stuff before driving around with them, obviously.
And you do that at the office. You know,
absolutely.
If they refuse to come to the office or refuse to meet you in a public place and they want to meet you at the property, then there's some other considerations. Great. You continue to – maybe you don't meet them or maybe you bring a partner along or two partners along. It just depends how you feel about that.
Yep. Good suggestion. What about going to a home to list the home? I guess that's how would you? Is there anything different you would do when you go to somebody's home that's their home?
Really good
question. Just let people know where you're going. That's a great question, though.
Really great question. So, again, I would implement all of the. So there's two things you can do on this. If on your initial call they check out and you're fine, that's, you know, make sure you're asking the right questions. Number one. Number two, you can always bring someone with you to your first meeting. And number three, it's not inappropriate to ask a listing to meet you first at the office.
Absolutely.
Or at Starbucks.
Absolutely.
If someone's like, well, I just want you to come check the house. Great, but it's our office policy that I meet all clients first at the office. Just come into the office. We'll talk about, I want to really present to you my marketing plan before I come check out the house. Okay.
Great question.
Great question.
Jay Fort said, what about, like, when you do feel uncomfortable saying, hey, somebody else is going to be coming to see the house shortly, so I'm just going to wait outside in case they show up. You know, that would be an uncomfortable feeling that you could get you out of the house, but also let them aware that there's somebody's going to be showing up as well. To maybe they'll panic, maybe they go, but it might get you out of a situation. So I thought that was a good idea.
I love that excuse, and that has been, that's mental preparation right there. That means
that is mental preparation. Yeah.
You role played this, and I love that when you can do this every time you show a property.
Every time
you get
every
in the car and say, I heard from the showing company or the listing company that there's like five showings at the same time. So if we run into somebody, you know, I'm sorry. I hope we don't run into anybody.
Great
response. Someone's thought that. Whoever asked that question or made that comment has thought this out. So I love it. Guys, it's okay to fib a little. It's okay to.
Just
for your safety, it's okay to lie.
Absolutely.
If you don't know that there's six people seeing the house, who cares? This is your safety.
Right. Vicky asked a great question. She says, "Locked door behind." Like once you get in with the person, she says, "Locked door behind you, so nobody else comes in." I don't know.
I don't like that. I don't like that either. In my opinion, you want to keep all your exits open.
Okay.
So I would not recommend locking the door behind you. I just would not recommend locking the door behind you.
Yeah. You know, and I like the, when you and I were talking yesterday, how if you do start to feel uncomfortable, position yourself across from a table. Like find, you know, and I guess if it's an empty house, it's a little hard to do. I would just get out of the house.
So working on that, like I said, role-playing with your spouse is a great way to, if someone's trying to invade your comfort bubble, placing an object between the two of you, walk around a table, talk over the table, walk around a couch, you know, all kinds of physical barriers to make sure that person knows that they are not getting close to you.
Yeah. Another, Ronaldo said, push your car panic alarm system if you have one. And know if you have one and know if it works. I love that idea.
So
that's loud, real loud.
So that your horn starts honking. Yeah, I love it.
Yep.
Great. I love it.
Cool. Hey, Eric, man, sincerely appreciate all this. Hey, guys, we're not doing this to scare people. I think the biggest thing is the mindset. For me, the biggest message was prepare yourself with what could happen or everything that could happen, every situation, every encounter. Be aware. Be in the moment. Stop looking at your phone, stop looking at your text, stop checking your email, stop playing on Facebook, and I'm not saying playing, but like it's so addictive to do that stuff, but when you think about your safety, it's not a time to be checking that stuff when you're with somebody or going to meet somebody. Start preparing yourself mentally for all the different situations and be alert, and I think that would have a huge factor on what this person will or can't do. I love the shark nudge. Be aware of that. And it's so easy to pick up on stuff like that if you're in the moment. So a lot of kudos, Eric. Great class. I really, really appreciate you doing this. And I appreciate everything you do with Breakthrough Broker and all just everything you have going. So, dude, I'd love to have you back on and share your other stuff to help agents. And, guys, I hope you got something out of this. I appreciate it. I would really appreciate it, any kind words you would. If you've never been with us or this is your first time, say something nice about Eric on the private Facebook group. We're at 10,000, almost 700, going to be to 11,000 soon. Don't be shy to ask questions, guys. If you don't ask questions, we can't help you. So it only shows up in the group. It doesn't get posted to your page or personal page. Your friends or family or coworkers don't see it. So the only way we can help is if you ask questions. Be safe, be in the moment, stay in yellow.
You guys can always tag me in a question. I'll be happy to answer. I'm part of a group. Also, my email is eric@breakthroughbroker.com. Common spelling, Eric, ERIC at breakthroughbroker.com. I'm happy to speak with any of your managers if you guys are doing some new policies and procedures around safety. I'm always happy to talk to anyone. It's what we do. So give me
an
email.
Best webinar so far, man. Best webinar so far, people are saying.
Well, thanks.
So,
I appreciate it. It's really nice.
Yeah, and I tell you, you know, and I'll leave you with this. Eric and I talked about this last night. It's like a lot of people have said, I've been to a safety course. I don't think there is enough safety courses out there. You can always pick up one more thing or one more mindset or one more saying or one more script or just the more you do it, the more you prepare, the more you're mentally ready for whatever is coming at you. I just think it's going to get you home safe at night. So I hope that we can help one more person, or God, I hope we can help millions of people to never have this happen to them. And just and if you, for whatever you do, have conversations with your children and your spouse and talk about this. I was talking about this last night. I couldn't stop talking about it with my wife and children last night. You know, after I had the conversation with you, Eric, and it was just it's just good to be aware. You know, you don't realize all the little things that could protect you. Just being mentally ready in your awareness and the, you know, your how you stand, just that little thing in itself is huge. So I appreciate everything you do, man, and I'm just glad to have you as part of the Agent Mastermind, man. I really am.
Yeah, it's fun. I love it too. I look forward to keeping in touch with anyone. Any of you California realtors on the call, I'll be at the car conference today. So come check me out.
Safe travels, brother.
Talk to you soon.
Take care, everybody. We'll see you same time, same place. Got an awesome class next week for you. Don't miss it. We will see you on the web. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.